Greetings, everyone, and welcome to the 2021 International Association of Black Actuaries Annual Meeting. We are so delighted to welcome the membership and allies from all across the globe as we celebrate Vision Without Boundaries at this, our annual meeting. I'm Chris Cooper, and I've been blessed to write two number one best-selling books and serve organizations and individuals across five continents as an executive and peak performance coach, speaker, trainer, and lifestyle and procrastination expert. But more importantly, I have the awesome pleasure and privilege of serving as a facilitator, leadership trainer, host, and as always, your master of ceremonies here for this incredible annual event. So as this year's theme, Vision Without Boundaries, states, regardless of this unconventional assembly, of course, we're virtual again this year, we wanted you to understand that we are committed to ensuring that we serve you, the membership, in an even more incredible way. You see, despite us being at the back end of a global pandemic and experiencing the awakening of a renewed focus on diversity, equity, and inclusion, the International Association of Black Actuaries is committed to dispel the myth that we must be disconnected or bound by society's limitations and expectations during these challenging times. Instead, we are here to empower you to rewrite the narrative and show that our vision can be boundless and our goals can be limitless. It's time for leadership reinvention, and you are indeed in the right place at the right time with the right people. So I encourage you to buckle up for a thrilling ride over the next couple of days. Our meeting structure has been redesigned to maximize your ability to participate and increase your professional development skills. Over the next 3 days, what's going to happen is that we're going to engage you and you're going to engage with us in one 30-minute express session and then one 90-minute general session daily. Both will be interactive and encourage each and every one of you to make your determination along with the guidelines from similar conferences as to the amount of continuing education units that you will earn. Every session this year directly ties to leadership development and is designed to provide you with the necessary skills to maximize your advancement opportunities within the profession. All sessions are being recorded and will be uploaded to YouTube as well. And as always, we know Cade and the rest of the team will make sure that access details will be provided at the conclusion of the conference. So let's get this party started with our first express session for today, which focuses on the actuarial market trends. The focus of this session is to lay the foundation and to give you perspective on what is happening in the marketplace and to provide you with positioning techniques to increase your ability to negotiate better in the profession and understand the opportunities that lie ahead. We are honored to have three dynamic leaders with us today to share the hottest segments, jobs and skill sets in the market, along with emerging trends to explore as you level up your career. So it's my pleasure to introduce Jake Spiteri, Vice President at Oliver James, Derek Mulder, Senior Director at DW Simpson, and Jacob Galecki, Managing Partner at Galecki Search. I'll turn it over to you gentlemen right now.
Thanks so much, Chris. And hi, everyone. If we go to the next slide, thanks, Kate. And the next one across. So as the slide says, I'm Jake Spiteri. I lead our North American actuarial team here at Oliver James Associates. My portion of the presentation is going to focus on the actuarial life market and the current trends we are seeing in an almost post-COVID world. So remote work was not only a necessity during COVID, but it was also a bit of respite to those of us with long tiresome commutes, families, and those of us who just get a little bit more done when we're left to ourselves. However, is it here to stay? Well, the good news is almost half of the new jobs we've been working on are open to remote candidates. Moreover, 32% of new positions would consider a remote candidate. However, they do have a preference for the candidate to be on site. And only 21% of new positions are dictating that they must be on site. Most of those on site positions are limited to large metropolitan areas such as New York City, whereas most of the remote jobs are in more remote areas. So that's good news for actuaries, as obviously give you a larger breadth of choice when considering a new position or company. There is also a continued rise of non-actuarial positions. More and more clients are asking for candidates with actuarial backgrounds for roles in strategy, corporate development, M&A, data analytics, and risk management. If you're interested, especially in these data or risk management type roles, a good starting point would be work on your coding skills, such as SQL, Python, and Alteryx. On the strategy, corporate development, and M&A side, the positions have been driven by the continued consolidation in the market and acquisitions led by the private equity firms. Many of them have taken the Apollo Athene approach. So we've seen BlackRock, Ares, the Carlyle Group have all made acquisitions recently, to name a few. And it's a trend that's proved to be extremely profitable for them. So you bet it's a trend that is going to continue. In the more traditional actuarial space, insurers are trying to gain further model efficiency through modernization. So actuaries with technical skills, such as GGY Axis, MG Alpha, and Profit, especially those who can code in those systems, are in really high demand. Due to the size and complexity of some of these projects, client-facing actuaries are being hired at an astonishing rate. Moreover, with a lot of the big looming regulatory deadlines, the assurance and thought leadership from the consultancies is being leaned on extensively to help deliver these complex changes. Direct insurers are also trying to keep costs in check by hiring folks with IFRS 17, LDTI, and PBR experience for some knowledge transfer. So that's a bit of a highlight of the life and retirement market at the moment. I'm now going to pass on to Derek, who'll give you an overview of the health market.
There we go. I'm off mute. Hopefully my video is working. My name is Derek Mulder. I've been at DW Simpson for a little over 18 years, and I'm just going to give you a brief rundown of the health market. Certainly with all of the ever-changing healthcare regulations and laws, there's plenty of insurance work for actuaries to do. Remote work is certainly prevalent following the pandemic, as I often tell people. I think one of the positive things to come from this, just to try to spin it, is that business seems to have changed, and more and more companies that have never been open to remote work are now open to that, or at least a hybrid situation. You know, we're hearing from people every week that are saying their company's asking them to come back full time in September or in January, and that's just not something that they're too interested in doing, and looking for the full time remote work or the hybrid work. And even as positions take 2, 3, 4 weeks to materialize, they're not seeing the candidates, we found companies are more willing to, for a perfect candidate, consider remote work. So for healthcare, I'd certainly say that demand has remained strong. Seen a few trends that I think are worth pointing out. Some specific experience, you know, long-term care, certainly premiums have continued to increase over the past several years. Low interest rates can affect the bond portfolios that involve long-term care, and policyholders are holding on to them a little bit longer than perhaps some of the insurance companies thought, and forcing them to raise their rates and get some additional work for actuaries. Certainly pharmacy, the general cost of prescription drugs has been steadily increasing, and they need actuaries behind the scenes to help them figure out how to make money there. With specialty health lines, we've seen new entrants in the kidney and dialysis space. We've also worked on a few startup opportunities with companies, a lot of them data analytics focused, really cool opportunities, and those are starting to become a little bit more prevalent as well. Healthcare economics is another area that actuaries, we've seen demand for, with, you know, all these costs continuing to increase, insurers and hospitals and other entities are hiring actuaries to understand the emerging medical and pharmacy expense trends there. data science and analytics, I think a theme of actuarial science these days, just being able to manipulate the data and understand it, strong technical abilities, Python, R, SQL, SAS, very sought after skills, being able to predict outcomes on a large amount of data certainly has become much more mainstream than it was a decade ago. The consulting firms are starting to hire again, we've seen, and certainly that's a very good sign for the general insurance industry and the actuarial community. Value-based care is another area where actuaries we've seen them want to be hired, where they're looking at the drivers of the medical cost trends. And with some of these stronger cost controls, because providers are paid on patient health outcomes, actuaries can play a vital role in the bottom line. Certainly Medicare and Medicaid, as long as the money's there, there's going to be work for actuaries. And, you know, I don't think that is ever going to change. We see a lot of demand for that across the board. So the health, I would say in general, healthcare actuarial work is extremely strong, continues to remain strong, and certainly doesn't show any signs of letting up. And now Jacob Galecki.
Hello, everyone. So apologies for being in a mask. I traveled for business for the first time yesterday, and getting a good dose of post, or I guess, as Jake put it, almost post-COVID travel, and my flight was canceled, and I've been stranded at an airport. So I'm coming to you live from the Atlanta Admirals Club today. So I do want to just point out a few similarities from the previous two comments that were made by Jake and Derek, that, you know, the remote stuff is remaining consistent across all the disciplines. We're seeing very similar trends there as they're observing on both the life and health sides as well. We are also seeing a, I would call it a precipitous increase in the demand for consulting talent as well. That's consistent across the board. I believe that many companies are looking to both on the insurance side and also on the self-insured side to increase the types of work that actuaries typically perform in the consulting side. So we're seeing quite a bit of that as well. You know, the major trend that we've observed and that's really driving a lot of things would be twofold. One would be the rise of these new startups and insurtech companies that are driving a lot of activity in the P&C job market generally. And some specific and interesting outcomes have come out of that. Most of these insurtech companies are starting out as MGAs, and so we're seeing a lot more activity on just the entire infrastructure that supports MGAs, from fronting carriers to reinsurance companies providing, you know, quota sharing in the form of like actively acting like playing the role of venture capitalists in that role. So we're seeing a lot of that. Of course, on the carrier side of things, we are seeing quite a bit of digital transformation. I think most companies are really getting very serious in realizing that they're not going to be able to compete with some of these newer companies unless they get all of the ducks in a row when it comes to how their data is stored and how it's extracted and it's been analyzed. And so massive data overhauls are occurring across all companies, and would very much involve actuaries with that. We're seeing an increase in the non-traditional side of things as well, seeing data being analyzed from multiple perspectives. And we feel that actuaries are well suited to perform analyses on a variety of data sets as it pertains to the property and casualty insurance industry, not just claims data. We're talking human capital, people analytics, marketing analytics, all of that stuff. And so, so we feel that behavioral science is a very interesting field that some actuaries probably need to be considering and thinking about and scaling up in that area. So I will hand it back over to Derek now to talk about some salary trends.
Okay. So Katie, these are our salary surveys as they stand right now. And you can just kind of slowly scroll through. I think we put quite a few of them in here. One thing I'll say is we have recently, over the past several months, gathered more data from the actual community than we ever have. And these salary surveys are going to be improved a great deal. And coming this fall, these slides are going to be more readable, easier to understand. There I am. Easier to understand and much more interactive. So we're pretty excited about what's coming with the salary survey. And we're also working on some other improvements that include the possibility of breakouts by gender and ethnicity. And we're hoping that that will break out sometime next year. So we're working through all that right now. You know, I think in regards to salary surveys in general, salaries are certainly trending up. Actuary skills are in very high demand in a number of different areas. The actuarial profession continues to get recognition, constantly rated as a top profession by US News and World Report. And it's certainly a good place to be. Just anecdotally, one thing I'll say that we've noticed is in this market, this very candidate-driven market, companies are paying more than perhaps they would have in years past for talent and for actuaries because it is difficult to attract them. So they're paying more. They're offering, as we talked about, the remote benefits. They're offering the hybrid work schedules. And it's a good time to be active if you've ever considered looking at new positions. So as she scrolls through, you can see these are what they look like now. And come fall, they're going to be really great. So that's all I've got for the salary surveys.
Excellent, gentlemen. Well, thank you once again, Derek, Jacob, and Jake, for your perspective in each of the respective areas. So I know that we have a few questions beginning to come through. If you do have a question, of course, this is an express session, so we won't be here for a long time. But if you do have a question, I encourage the audience members to go ahead and put it in the Q&A box. And our moderators will ensure that I receive them. I did get a couple of questions coming in. So I'll first begin with this one. And this one actually will be for each of the three gentlemen, Derek, Jacob, and Jake. And it's basically a question in regards to the availability of actuarial roles, both kind of on the entry level and the management level. Has there been somewhat of a shift, I guess, pre-COVID and now in this post/during COVID period, I guess, from a life, health, and a PNC perspective. So I'll throw that in. Derek, you're on the screen now. So I'll begin with you. So what are you seeing, I guess, in regards to the availability of actuarial roles, both from the entry level and management role, specifically, from the health perspective?
Yeah, I'll say across the board, we've seen an amazing uptick in the number of positions. You know, last year was brutal for a lot of different reasons, certainly business-wise, and companies stopped hiring people. You know, actuaries, anybody wanted to stay in their lane and not move and mm-hmm. see what was going to happen with COVID. And as the new year turned towards the end of January, we really started to see companies say, hey, we have these business needs, we're ready to hire. And it's been a really big influx of new positions. There's positions all over the country at all levels. We do have an entry-level team that does work on some positions. I would say probably the middle manager, 7 to 15 year is probably the most sought after years of experience, but generally across the board in actuarial, it's a really hot market right now. Would you guys agree?
Awesome. Okay. What are you seeing from a life perspective, Jake?
Yeah, it was last year. Everyone was sort of didn't know what was going to happen. Everyone was in a holding pattern. So hiring stopped, but the work still needed to be done. And I know there was a lot of pressure on everyone to get it sorted, especially the regulatory issues. So now that we've come into the new year and we have some sort of roadmap out of it, companies are a lot more confident in hiring. With interest rates still low, they're still trying to reduce costs. And that's including our costs as well as a recruitment partner. However, we are still seeing a number of jobs at all levels coming through. So if you ever thought about moving, people that we're working with are often getting 3, 4, sometimes 5 different offers from clients that they can choose from and negotiate against and get a better position and more money.
Excellent. Excellent. And from your perspective, Jacob, looking at PNC?
Yeah, I completely agree with Sosik and Derek. I have observed exactly the same thing. I will just add to the discussion that positions typically come about by two mechanisms. One is it's growth, and then it's also turnover. And so I think what we're seeing, and correct me if I'm wrong, Derek and Jake, but I'm feeling there's really a lot of massive turnover going on at the moment. There's a lot of activity in the market just generally. And it's driving a lot of new opportunities. And there's also, that's also coupled with growth, and that's always a really good mix, at least when you're in the recruitment business, there's just a lot of opportunities out there at the moment.
It's gotcha. just to add to that, it's good turnover though. And it's good turnover for actuaries because they're able to dictate more of what they want. They can dictate remote jobs and it's opening up to more clients that they can go at. It's forcing clients as well to really question their recruitment processes, two, their internal teams as well and how they treat them as well. And three, as you saw from the salary survey, what they pay people as well. So I think there's a difference between turnover and really good turnover. And this is good for actuaries.
Excellent. Excellent. And I love the fact that you're also talking kind of on the retention piece as well, right? Because the market has expanded so much and people do have options, organizations doing what's required to keep the top talent, that kind of stuff, I think is very paramount now. Excellent. All right. Next question. This actual one is for Derek. Do salary surveys account for regional wage differences?
We're trying to incorporate that in. It's difficult to do. We've had some salary surveys for Canada specific, for the US specific. And speaking of North America, we are working on trying to get it in more regional. I think our salary surveys take out the bottom 10% of salaries, the top 10% of salaries, and then it's averaged from there. So the regional differences, unless you're talking about San Francisco and New York and some very high cost of living areas, it's gonna generally be pretty similar.
Got it. Okay, thank you. This question, I'll throw it at Jake. Have there been any shift to data analytics positions in the industry? And are actuarial exams currently relevant to these positions?
Really, really good question. And I think, as I said, in the life market, there has been a big push for the analytical experience and knowledge that the actuaries have that can go over into data science and data analytics. One of the key areas that if anyone is considering those is some of the coding skills that may be a little different that they have to pick up. So Python, Alteryx and SQL, as I said. But yes, there is a big shift, not in life, I know in PNC and health as well. So across the board. In terms of the actuarial exams, I wish I knew how difficult they were. I hear it all the time. I actually tried to do one practice one once, and I've got an economics degree, and I couldn't make right or left of it, to be honest with you. So, look, I always think, as you saw in those salary surveys, I think the more exams that you have is the better for your salary, and I think it always bodes well for anyone going across. However, there are some fundamental differences between, you know, data analytics and say the actuarial route. And just because you're an FSA doesn't mean you may be a great data analytics person. So what I would personally focus on more, if you're keen on going down that route, is the coding skills and maybe some courses around that.
Awesome. Thanks for sharing. And the next one, I guess I'm going to throw it to you, Jacob. Do you see firms reevaluating the need for fellow versus associate credentials, and particularly mid-career levels that are also considering some non-traditional roles?
Yeah, this is something that I think is very specific to specific companies. And I it's hard for me to speak to this as a general trend. I will say that I have observed over the past year that some companies that have been very traditionally fellow focused, shall we say, have opened it up and been much more appreciative and open to hiring career associates in that. So I will throw out that anecdotal remark, but I hesitate to provide a general comment on it. And then in terms of what was the latter part of the question, I just want to make sure I'm answering it correctly.
It was particularly geared toward the mid-career level that may be considering some non-traditional roles. So these individuals that may not actually, I guess, be a fellow yet, right, but are in a mid-career role and they're thinking about potentially moving to a non-traditional.
I'll provide some anecdotal references here rather than a general statement, but I have observed a number of companies seeking out mid-level or mid-career individuals with actuarial skill sets without regard to having any exams necessarily or a credential. There are so within product management, within rate filing and rating analysts, people doing pricing work but don't actually need to actually have the credential. We're seeing that I guess from my perspective, it's the personal lines business at the moment on the PNC side is just so red hot, and pricing is becoming a really key focus for them. So they're really open to a variety of backgrounds, provided that they have the actual actuarial skill set to help them expand into different states, different lines of business, different product features and things like that. So we're finding a lot of demand on that pricing side without regard to exams.
Okay, excellent. I know, and these questions are rolling in, guys. I know we won't get to all of them in the time that we have. So I definitely thank you for your patience. And we'll figure out a way to get some of those questions answered. But I want to give the last two questions. So first one for Derek, and then I'm going to have one that's going to be a last question that I would like each of you to address, please. So for Derek, the question is, are you seeing any noticeable changes in the demand on actuarial positions from the international markets outside of North America?
That's tough. Not so much, more one-off. I think on the international side, you know, we used to be pretty involved in Asia and Australia, and there's a lot of competition over there with other recruiters. And so we have not, outside of a few companies that have offices that would consider somebody maybe moving to Switzerland or Hong Kong. But we have not seen a whole lot of shift there, to be honest.
Okay. Thank you. That's fair. All right. And the last question, of course, you know, we're speaking to the International Association of Black Actuaries. So the last question is simply this. I'm going to ask each of you, have any specific advice for aspiring Black actuaries on how to find their first job? And I'll start with you, Derek, since I just
Sure. Yeah. You know, I think the first job can be difficult and patience is key, staying with it and trying to have as many conversations as possible to find something that you really want so that you don't have to settle, I think is very important. I think, you know, keep your LinkedIn completely updated. That is certainly something that employers go to look at, make sure that, you know, your social media accounts are clean, that they can't go find something on there that you don't want them to see, a potential employer. And just have, open, honest conversations with as many companies as you can and try to find that right position.
Awesome. What about you, Jake?
Yeah, on top of that, I would say, you know, the more actuarial exams pass, the better. That's always going to be one. But yeah, networking, meet, speak to people. Doesn't have to be people hiring. It can be, you know, people who graduated a year before you, internal referrals, anyone that you know that can help you, anyone who can vouch for you on a personal level, anyone can get you in front of a business going to help. So yeah, it's constantly putting yourself out there, which can often be tough and scary, but network.
Awesome. Fantastic. And Jacob.
Yeah, that was going to be my piece of advice as well, is the networking piece. I think that too often people take a literal approach to job searching, and it's like, okay, here's a job. I'm going to submit my resume to this or apply to this job. networking is really key. Many jobs exist outside of posted positions that are out there. So networking is really important. I will throw in another comment as well, is that I think another area that entry-level actuaries specifically could really be thinking about is to remember too that these companies are hiring you to do something, to perform some work. And while actuarial exams are extremely important and a vital component of that, but don't let that come at the expense of developing strong technical skills as well and demonstrating those on LinkedIn or through GitHub or however, that could really set you apart from some other entry-level actuarial candidates that you have a little bit of a leg up from a technical perspective as well.
Fantastic. Thank you, Derek, Jake, and Jacob. We really appreciate your time and giving us this valuable insight. And I'll just throw this one in. I know we talked about the networking aspect, the technical skill enhancement, the personal and professional development skills that everyone is developing. But I would actually just be resourceful. Use your resources. The IABA is an amazing resource connected with tons of individuals that are in positions that you aspire to become. And we are a community and a family of individuals that are committed to your development and your growth within the profession and even outside. So I wanted to make sure that we did share that. We are so excited once again, very grateful to Mr. Derek Mulder, to Jake Spiteri, and to Jacob Galecki for their time today. This is an express session, so we're going to make sure that we get through these quickly as we promised. Make sure that everyone tunes in just another 25 or so minutes. We're going to have our general session for today, which is Journey to Leadership with George Nichols III. Has an amazing bio. We're going to have a great kind of fireside chat conversation with him, all about a journey to leadership. But once again, wanted to thank everyone for attending this first session as we kick off the 2021 annual meeting. Once again, we may be, disconnected somewhat, but we are definitely connected through the technology. And I am so excited to be with all of you today. So thanks again, Derek, Jake, and Jacob. We definitely appreciate your time and your insight. If you do have additional questions, guys, we won't be, tabulating a list. Feel free to use those networking skills and get in contact with these guys and ask them these questions. We're going to give you some real life experience of networking and positioning yourself to get the answers to the questions that you need. So thanks so much once again, and we'll see you in the next session. Guys, have a great day, and I'll see you soon.